We're going to solve together our next related rates problem. This one, another classic that often appears on exams. A 10-foot ladder leans against a wall. The base of the ladder slides horizontally away from the wall at 2 feet per second. As a result, the top of the ladder moves down the wall. At what rate is the top of the ladder sliding down the wall when the base is 8 feet from the wall? We'll use our four-step problem-solving strategy for related rates problems to tackle this, since it works every time. We first draw a picture of the situation, which is a ladder leaning against a wall. Once you draw the picture, you might notice right away that the ladder forms a right triangle with the floor and the wall. And this geometry of the right triangle will be crucial to our solution and is a big clue to the approach we'll use. The ladder is 10 feet, a fact that we'll set aside for the moment as we think about what's going on. As time passes in the problem, the base of the ladder slides horizontally along the ground, which causes the top of the ladder to move down the wall. Notice that the ladder never loses contact with the ground or the wall. Now, of course, if the ladder slides along the ground faster instead, then it slides down the wall more quickly too. The rate at which it slides horizontally is thus somehow related to the rate at which it slides down vertically, and our job will be to find that exact relationship. Let's assign some variables to mark the location of the ladder's ends at each moment. We'll use x for the horizontal distance from the wall to the ladder's base, and y for the vertical distance from the floor to the ladder's top. The problem tells us the rate at which the ladder's base slides horizontally, that is, the rate at which its x position changes, which is dx dt, the rate at which x varies with respect to time t. We're told that that rate is 2 feet per second. The problem then asks us to find the rate at which the ladder's top moves down the wall, and so we want the rate dy dt, the rate at which y varies with respect to time t. Specifically, we have to find the rate at the instant when x equals 8 and the base is 8 feet from the wall. So we're given dx dt equals 2 feet per second, and we're asked to find the value of dy dt. We thus need the relation between dx dt and dy dt. To find that, we back up a step and first need to develop a relation between x and y. And that's the second step of our strategy, to write an equation that relates the quantities of interest, in this case, between x and y. In any related rates problem, you'll use one of four approaches that you need to know to complete this step. We cover all of them in our free materials on our website. For this latter problem, the right triangle we've drawn tells us that we'll use the Pythagorean theorem to develop our equation. You'll find that you use the Pythagorean theorem a lot in your solution to related rates problems, and it should be your go-to choice anytime you have a right triangle and you need to relate the lengths of the two legs. The key thing to realize is that as the ladder slides down the wall, at every moment the x and y legs of the triangle form a right triangle with the 10-foot ladder as the hypotenuse. Hence, at every moment, x squared plus y squared equals 10 squared, which equals 100. A common mistake at this point is to substitute 8 feet for x, but you can't proceed correctly if you do that. Instead, because the location of the ladder's base changes as the ladder slides along the ground, we have to leave x as a variable for now. We'll substitute x equals 8 feet at the end of our solution. By contrast, the ladder's length is always 10 feet, and so we use that as a fixed value in our equation here. And that's it. We now have the relation we need between x and y, and so we're done with the second step of our strategy. That brings us to the third step. Take the derivative with respect to time of both sides of the equation, remembering the chain rule when we do so. We then have d dt of x squared plus ddt of y squared equals ddt of 10 squared. The derivative of 10 squared, or of 100, is 0, since that's the derivative of a constant. On the left-hand side of the equation, we have the derivative ddt of x squared, which is 2x times dx dt, plus the derivative ddt of y squared, which is 2y dy dt. And that all equals 0. The 2x and 2y parts of the derivatives are probably clear to you, since we started with x squared and y squared. If the dx dt and dy dt terms are also clear to you, then you can use the link you should now see to skip over the next part of this discussion, which is a detour for a bit to discuss specifically why those terms are there. The key thing to realize is that we're taking the derivative here with respect to time t. Specifically, while the derivative with respect to x of x squared is 2x, and the derivative with respect to y of y squared is 2y, the derivative with respect to time t of x squared is 2x times dx dt, and the derivative with respect to time t of y squared is 2y times dy dt. Why are those dx dt and dy dt terms there? To answer that, let's go back to our Pythagorean equation, x squared plus y squared equals 10 squared. But now, let's explicitly show the time dependence of both x and y, which are both functions of time t, so we'll show them as such to emphasize the point. Let's again take the derivative with respect to time of both sides of the equation, so we have ddt of x as a function of time t squared, plus ddt of y as a function of t squared equals ddt of 10 squared. That last term is 0, again, since the derivative of a constant is 0. For the first term on the left-hand side, we have the derivative ddt of something in brackets that's squared. As usual, when we take the derivative, the 2 comes down in front, and we have 2 times that thing in brackets, which is x of t. But we also have to remember the chain rule and apply ddt to what's inside the brackets, which gives us the chain rule term ddt of x of t. Let's be clear, x is a function of time t, even though we don't know exactly what that function is. It doesn't matter. Whatever the function is, it has a derivative with respect to time t, and that is this term ddt of x of t, which we can also write as dx of t dt. This dx dt term, due to the chain rule, is very important when you're solving related rates problems, and it's easy to forget. But if you do forget it, you'll probably quickly realize the omission when you don't have any rates to relate. That'll be a reminder to go back and put the chain rule term in. Let's finish taking our derivatives here, now looking at the second term, ddt of y of t squared, which is 2y times dy dt, with the same sort of chain rule term as we had for dx dt. And that all equals 0. Now notice that both of these chain rule terms have to be here in order for us to relate dx dt and dy dt as we actually set out to do. With that, remember that we explicitly wrote both x and y here as functions of time in order to illustrate why these chain rule terms are here. Typically, you would never write all that out, and instead you'd just write x squared plus y squared equals 10 squared as we did before, and then take your derivatives and obtain 2x dx dt plus 2y dy dt equals 0. The math is all the same in the right and left columns here. The only difference is that on the left, we showed all the time dependencies to show you where the chain rule terms come from. But once you understand that, you can use the shorthand notation as we have on the right. So with that, let's return to where we were. With the equation we have here, we can divide both sides by 2 to get x times dx dt plus y times dy dt equals 0. And with that, we have the relation between dx dt and dy dt that we need, and so we're done with the third step of our strategy. That takes us to the fourth step, which is to solve for the quantity we're after. Remember, we want the value of dy dt at the instant when x equals 8 feet. So let's isolate the y dy dt term on the left, and move the x dx dt term to the right side of the equation, where it becomes negative. We can then divide both sides of the equation by y to get rid of it from the left, and we're left with dy dt equals negative x over y times dx dt. We'd like to substitute values at this point, but while we know the value of x is 8 feet at our moment of interest, we don't yet know the value of y to be able to plug it into our equation here. And so to find that, we need to solve a quick subproblem. Remember that the Pythagorean theorem holds at every moment as a situation progresses, so at every moment x squared plus y squared equals 10 squared is true. So when x equals 8 feet, we have 8 squared plus y squared equals 100, or since 8 squared is 64, 64 plus y squared equals 100. That means y squared equals 100 minus 64, which is 36, and so y equals the square root of 36, which is 6. And so y equals 6 feet when x equals 8 feet. And that completes our little subproblem. So let's put the result over here on the right, and we can return to our main problem and finally find the value for dy dt by substituting in the various values. We have, at the moment we're interested in, x equals 8 feet and y equals 6 feet, so we can make those substitutions. And we were given that dx dt equals 2 feet per second. So now we're just left with multiplication. Negative 8 over 6 times 2 is negative 8 over 3. And looking at units, the feet in the numerator and denominator here cancel, and so we're left with feet per second, as we expect. It's the same units that dx dt has. And that's it. Our final answer is dy dt equals negative 8/3 feet per second. You might wonder why the value is negative. The reason is that y decreases as the ladder slides down the wall, and so dy dt has a negative value as y becomes smaller as time passes. Indeed, something would be wrong if we didn't get a negative value for dy dt for that reason. That said, here's a warning. If you are using a web-based homework system, there's an issue that often causes students a lot of frustration. Depending on how the question got coded into the problem database, you might need to enter a positive value instead, so positive 8/3 feet per second, because sometimes they've already taken the negative sign into account when they asked how fast the ladder is sliding down the wall, since the word down already implies a negative value. Just depends on what the coder entered as the sign of the answer when they put the problem in, and unfortunately they're inconsistent about that. So the system may mark you wrong for the simple reason and then not give you any useful feedback so you know what the problem is. Generally, if you think you've solved a related rates problem correctly and got a negative value, but the system is rejecting it, try entering the positive value instead and see if that works. It probably will. Here's a summary screen of all the steps we used to solve this problem, so you can screen grab it if you want. Remember that we use these same four steps to solve every related rates problem that we encounter, and you can too. You can download this problem-solving strategy for yourself and see more calculus problems, each with a completely worked-out solution, at our website, mathano.com. Please also subscribe to our YouTube channel, and you can go immediately now to a video solution of another related rates problem, one that has a different twist. For now, please let us know the questions you have or any suggestions. We'll do our best to help.